movement has to be larger than life and slower than life because the audience is further away than they are when they're talking to you. What you can do when you're talking to a friend from this distance is vastly different to what you do if you're standing dead in the street. And you know that from your own experience. Well, perhaps you don't really know. You know what I mean? You have to, must have big, generous movements to have an effect at all. Right, we've almost got us up to back to back. But once this up and back to back.
Thank you.
Why don't you quote the original words? This is important because in the end, if you can come up with something better, as Lester Ramsden says, you know, then we all want to know about it. Just, the dancers on one side spring into the air and strike the sticks of their opposites held overhead at arm's length thrice. What it doesn't mean, of course, is holding up your opposite. Yeah, to do this, will the evens all take the stick in both hands and turn the face away. Now, what I want you to think about
is, the is
again, the safety aspect of this. If you lower the stick behind your head, the chances are that your head will be hit. If you hold it forward because your arms don't make it high, and I do know somebody who has that problem, then you're almost certain to be hit on the head. The safest place is above your head, as high as you can reach. This way, the stick hitting is going as far away from your head as possible. Also, if the hitter remembers what I said about tightening the hand, so there's no follow through, even if at the moment being hit you drop your stick, you don't actually get hit. Top hat. Yeah. Drunken Morris persons I make no allowance for. But it is important to get it all. In turning, you'll find if you turn, you can't actually turn without moving your feet, otherwise you end up with your legs crossed, knotted if you're not careful and so on. What you do is you deliberately plant. In a dance like Brighton Camp, where you're taking alternate hits, you actually will be turning the same way all the time. But we're not going to do that. This one, the evens. Now, having turned so that the evens got the stick up, when the evens hold their stick up, everywhere, the other three have got three hits. And a half tone. At the other half, guess who hits the other half?
As soon as they recover.
Right.
Revenge.
Well, not really.
Just testing.
Thank you.
very close to it.
Thank you.
and light steps. What they really meant with heavy is the terms of aim at crunch. Engine was considered a heavy step. Not necessarily in banging, there's a lot of digger came into it. And a nutty girl has a heavy incisor. They are movement scientists, larger than before, you really go to town with it. And it's a sort of in a straight line type sidestep. But it's wrong to call it a sidestep. In the Cotswold, there are not so fussy about as we would be about the difference between stepping and what I would call a sidestep, a closed sidestep or an open sidestep, because there are many people who just dance like that, called that a normal step. In fact, one of the problems at Headington is that the Kimber family had it one way and the Trafford, Howard, other lot had it the other way. And you'll probably find in your own clubs that there are all some people who are convinced that the Morris step is like this, a sort of skip change, country dance type step. And if you follow traditional practice, you've got somebody who's odd. So the rest of you adjust until they go. Usually far less trouble than trying to make somebody odd change the way they do it, because they only feel embarrassed, you'll feel embarrassed, they'd never get it right, and so on anyhow. Right. So it's just four bars of that, then you half hay. Middles come up the middle, right? So you get to the other end. At the other end, let's just walk a half hay, off it goes half. You then face up again, and you do exactly the same thing. Four bars of stepping, and the middles come up. Bottoms turn out and wait their turn, right? Off you go. Right. So in fact, whoever's at the top is the top, and at the bottom is the bottom, they're not actually labelled 1, 2, 5, and 6. Happy? side.
Huh?
I'm just going to see what's...
Just for
I see no point in trying to run through conditions. This morning, there was some point to introduce you a number of ideas of movement, old dancers, new dancers, food for thought. This afternoon, I want to pass on some of the things I know about the way dancers were done. Right? It doesn't mean this is the way they have to be done. I'm just going to say this is the way they were done. We're going to try and learn a dance from the villages, different villages around Snow, Witchwood Forest sort of area, right? So we spend a lot of time learning something new, but the idea is to think about what we're learning and the movements and how one tradition, as it were, contrasts with another. Now this is a part of the world where dancers used to migrate from one team to another. Around Witchwood Forest, for example, there are a large number of sides, all at different times, differing from who actually led them. They know if the side moved from village to village, depending on who the foreman was. Each foreman would call on his friends, neighbours, mostly relatives to share the money with, to form sides. So there was a continuity to the sides, even if they actually had different leaders that were sort of normally thought of as coming from different places. Nothing changes. It's so surprising when the more you know about the tradition, the Morris before 1900, the more you realise it was done by ordinary people like you and I. You know, with all the same sort of foibles and things, that sort. Well, we're going to start by doing a Beddington dance. Now, Beddington's interesting. Interesting because it's one of several traditions that's been collected more than once from different generations. There was an old Beddington side, dancer which were met by Tinney and Butterworth, and there were the young Beddington side who were met, or one of the ones who was met by Sharp, were essentially met by members of the Travelling Morris. That's people like Kenwood and Schofield, Cage and Douglas Kennedy was with them, so on, Arthur Peck, people of that generation. And the young Beddington side was raised by the fiddler and the fool of the old side. Now I have to say it that way because it's important for you to realise there was a significant difference between the way the two generations danced. The old generation who had two leaders, Gibbs and Wright, danced with shuffles and things like this, and that was the tradition that Sharp attempted to publish in the Morris book, the second edition of the Morris book, book 5. He had been collecting from Benfield the Fiddler, and it's his picture who appears on the front cover of the Fiddler's Tune book, publicly it says. They collected from him dances which he published earlier in the first edition of book 3, which really the way the young men had danced. There are other aspects about the young men. They, when they were old, and they were young, they were actually teenagers, you know, 17, 18 year old. They were not older men, this is a bunch of youngsters who got together to dance old fates and so on. And when they're in their 40s and 50s and collected from, they had the tales about the old Morris competitions and the other clubs. You know, they remembered all of the stories and things of that sort. And they had attempted to teach their dances to people. Unfortunately, the one who knew most, George Hathaway, the leader, was crippled with arthritis and actually could only explain steps and so on with his fingers. He was actually unable to do it. And one of the problems has been in getting, as it were, a definitive way of the young Beddington side dancing, is that of 8 people I have on a picture who were watching George Hathaway teach, 5 of them had different ideas about what he explained. So, you know, there are multiple interpretations. Despite the fact there's a bit of film, Simon Pilgrim, They actually show you can do it. You're actually teaching and dancing so on. People come with different ideas of the emphases that should be placed and so on. Russell worked the Ross, who works at the Natural History Museum, and so on, and Lyon and so on, had different impressions of what they were actually taught. Now, we all, everybody, danced the sharp version of Leadington to 1949. Now, up till the end of the war, you learnt your Morris via a class, and you entered for certificates, or even badges, but you know, you went up a hierarchy of dance in different traditions. You learned to get different qualifications and so on. And there was a standard way, which everybody learned. And you could take a Morris dancer on one side, put them in another, and you couldn't really tell the difference. Hence the origin of mass Morris, because if you got 50 or 60 Morris men together, they only had half a dozen dancers that were anywhere, and they were all the same one. So they were actually, you know, proper. You all learned the same set of dancers. And this was certainly true when I started learning Morris in the 50s. But after the last war, Russell Workley said, but the young men didn't do the slow capers like that. They actually didn't do galleys, they did hooks. They did hooks where they did people do shuffles and things like this. And for some reason or other, it took the Morris world by storm. And when I first learned to do Morris, we were in the first flush of the new Leadington, as it were. And that was the tradition I started on in the early 50s, and therefore sort of a bit of the core of my understanding of things. Since then, of course, there have been, you know, as always, oscillations. People have looked up the old material, who understand things a bit better than what they were, that we did at those sort of time and so on. But it does mean there's more than one way of doing it in circulation, right? But what I would try and do is to teach you today those things that I am sure about. And you take it or leave it, right? You know, just tell you what it is, right? Now, the first thing about Leadington is that they were next door to other sides. Aldington, Loughborough, in particular, I won't say they were right besides those sides that draw people in their area. I say draw people because with Loughborough, Harry Taylor was at Loughborough and he was sort of tender leader in that one. It was a side at Lower Swell, and sometimes they danced together, or he invited people to dance with him, or they invited him to dance with them, and so on. It was a bit of a confused picture. The last Loughborough side that danced was sort of quite late in the 19th century. It was after Harry Taylor's time. They actually danced a Loughborough and Lower Swell Morris. It was publicised, had an advert in the local paper, dancing in Morton. And they had a stick dance. You know, so much for Loughborough being all there. And in fact, Chipping Camden, who were a deliberate expansion of their repertoire by Dennis Hathaway, he was a man who came from Coldicott, the village next to Loughborough. He remembered the Loughborough Morris, and when he got involved with playing for Chipping Camden, he introduced Loughborough dancers to Chipping Camden. And this included the Loughborough handkerchief dance, the Loughborough stick dance, and the Loughborough country dance. You make of it what you will, but you know, the sensible interpretation is that repertoires never stood still, and that somebody who danced in the 1860s, 1870s didn't necessarily dance like somebody who was dancing in the 1880s, 1890s and so on. My contact with Loughborough, with Harry Taylor and so on, was in fact wandering through the village with Morris site and actually meeting his sons, who actually remembered the revival of Morris, people coming to the village and talking, you know, meeting people and the village. And we'll come back to Loughborough in a while. All right, Leadington.
Right, just before you get going, we see the problem with tonight. Many 14 people who got food, I'm fairly certain there are more than 14 people who intend to stay. Anybody who intends to stay here fails to book their meal.
difference. One side had a jump every 2 bars, another jump every 4 bars. One that's close to the rim, one that's far off the rim. But yeah, it's not very different, is it? Right? Of course, you'll find that that's the difference between chalk and cheese. And if you don't know what chalk and cheese is, you're not a Wiltshire man. Because in Wiltshire, the difference between whether you're on the hills or on the flat clay, the difference between the chalk and the clay. Right. Flemington liked to dance low, what they called low. In other words, they danced not high up on the toes, but a little bit dead. Right? Bend the leg a bit and dance. So, it suits most Morris men anyway. You shoot the leg over, they'd actually have to push yourself off the grain. But remember, it's a quick change of feet. It's not a smooth. Can't think of the right word, but it's a quick change of movement. Like a classic Renaissance step. Now, the argument came about what was the Flemington hand movement. Even in 1924-25, there was some concern about where the hands were. Because Sharp, who promulgated Longborough, made it quite clear that Longborough was up here. And the story went round that Flemington was the other way round. You see, so promptly, everybody danced Flemington. This is 70 years ago, really, right? People were doing it that way. But those people were spoken to were quite clear that the handkerchiefs in Flemington are in the vertical plane. Vertical. They are circles in inverted commas. Because they're actually ellipses, because the emphasis is on the up. With a flip of the handkerchief going. Which is, it's one thing for the hands to be doing circles between here and here. Right? They are vertical circles. But the other thing you've got is the wrist to make the handkerchief give you yum, buddy, yum, and give the appearance of the lift. If you're not lifting the body because you're being low, you let the handkerchief dance for you. If you make the handkerchief go into the grain, you know, emphasize that, then you look more like a mole than a Morris dance. A It's very simple. If you're going to turn the other way, you plop one foot halfway around the turn, you raise the thigh, twist the rein, pulling this up all in, and face the other way. And you do it very smoothly. Step, smooth, turn. Right? It's up. Levington didn't do it like that. They actually had a long sweep. They have brought the foot around. Now, none of us do it like this, don't they? So they brought the foot around in one movement, right? So they started and got the one little kick. Now, as you may know, if you've ever been taught by somebody nowadays, is in fact all that's remembered is the kick, which is no longer a turn, it's just a sort of kick, right? What I want to see is nice red. What do I do with the hands while I'm doing that? Well, we have another problem. Eight, in, down, and up. Right? Eight, in, down, and up. Eight, in, down, and up. No, you can't think eight, in, down, and up. It's even like that. It's eight, in, and down, up. Basically, in the slows and the galley, or the hook in Bennington, the arms are not still, they are moving all the way through. In fact, the stylistic characteristic we're looking for is flow. Some dancers, some traditions, like to hold poses. Bennington flow. Yeah. Yum, butter, dee, dee, yum, butter, dee. The hands keep going. Right. Let's just go try a foot up. You are going to face me. We're going to do two double steps, starting with your outside foot. The outside foot being the one that's opposite to your opposite. And you're going to do a hook, a turn, a sweep, to face the other way. We're then going to do two steps, double steps facing down, starting with the outside foot, which is now the opposite outside foot to the outside foot before, although it's obviously your opposite. Right? And we then hook back the other way. Go on, watch yourself. Which tune you want to play? Would you like to take over left behind me? Are we ready? Yum, ba-di-di, yum, ba-di-di. Now you notice, when I come up, I go straight in to the next play. So there's no pause there. So let's try it again. Ta yum ba di di yum ta di di yum ta di di yum ta da ba di di yum ta di di yum ta di da ta di yum.
Come back!
Now we concentrate on getting this flow in forward and back. And don't worry about the flow into the second half yet. Keep moving. But it's not on the spot. Try and keep going along the path that you expect to go. Same thing. actually all trying to face a cross, which requires everybody to be a bit more aware of their position than normal. Right? So for the moment, I just mentioned that one of the options is to end up like this halfway, but we're not going to fuss about it. Haze, half haze, are normal Morris haze on two bars with a hook at the end when you get there. And the rule I said about standing hardcore of turning quickly to go down and so on applies. There's one other trick though. Now, will these ladies start walking a half pace? One, two, three, and stop. Right? Now, what I would like you to be in this position is a bit closer, a bit closer, and a bit closer. Right? So you're in a tight bunch. Then you hook out to where you're going. Eight. You were in the middle to start with. Nothing like making life difficult, right? So, for example, if you're in the middle, right, you go, ready, one, two, three, and one, two, three, and eight. Right? I want you to come into a bunch and hook eight. A lot of our ideas about what eight means, right? In my opinion, what they're talking about was eight from the middle, not eight relative to some weird or wonderful other source, right? Come in a bunch and do it. Let's just try some haze. you mean by doing cross, cross, paper, and how much emphasis you put on it. Because it varies from Lionel, who was convinced he was taught with lots of waving around, to me, who was convinced that what they all were being taught was something that looks like something like Longborough, which is one, two, paper, paper, without this big jump to one side or the other at all. But from my point of view, this workshop, it's the hands flow. Right. Now, let's move on to their neighbours, Longborough. Just over the hill was a side that shared dances with them, in the sense that somebody like Minnie Taylor of Oddington danced with both teams. And I might say he danced with his friend Sam Bennett of Ilmington as well. So the man was probably the first of the modern Morris men who could do it all, or not, as the case may be. He was collected from when he was in his 80s. And he was still very active. He was blind in one eye, and apparently he practiced, showed the dances on his cobbled floor in his kitchen, or his daughter's kitchen, and it was, as the cobbles were wet, he was kicking the furniture over and things like this, and his daughter got very upset with the whole thing, I might say. He was met by Rolf Gardner, who somebody may not have heard of nowadays, but he was somebody who had vision. Wasn't terribly practical, well, I mean, he was in a way, but he had a vision. And at the end of the First World War, he wanted to resolve the conflict between the peoples of ourselves and the Germans. And he was set about trying to organise a tour of North Germany, taking the Morris with him. And that fell through, partly because Mr. Sharp didn't approve. He didn't approve to the extent that he removed all the Cambridge University students who were going on the Charlie Morris tour from the performance of Old King Cole, which Sharp had written. But the arrangements fell through. So they said, what should we do? We're going to the Cotswolds. So in June 1924, they got on the bikes, literally, went to Bulford and set out for a cycling tour of the Cotswold villages. And to their amazement, they actually met these old dancers at places like Beddington and Mongra and things like this. Old men like Harry Taylor, who had never thought he'd ever see Morris dancing again. They hadn't been part of his life for 20 or 30 years. You know, they'd never seen it again there. And apparently these are old dancers. Their eyes, you know, full of tears and so on. They couldn't actually praise them enough. It's because they were there, not because they're really good, you know, that's all. They realised. Of course, that was the start of the realisation they're still working. The other magical thing about it, certainly for those who were on it, is that the last day of the tour, the Travelling Morris, they were dancing on the green in the middle of Adderbury, where the Banbury Road goes to the middle of Adderbury, on the green there. And about the time, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, when Sharp died, and Rolf Gardner and Heffer, that generation, were terribly moved by this coincidence. You know, they've actually taken the dances back from people that met the tradition, things like this, you know. And it's almost like somebody had passed the baton on to them. You know, they're terrible. And Rolf Gardner, as I say, who was a born romantic in this sort of sense, he actually got his father, who was the composer, uncle, his composer, Balfour Gardner, to buy a farm down in Dorset, south of Gillingham, in Fontenoy Magna. I'm trying to think what it was called, about Springhead, the mill. And they built a gold farm up on top of the hill at a time when the countryside was absolutely empty. You know, Dorset was always poor agriculture in the sense of poor wages, you know, poor productivity, but poor in terms of making money out of it. And they could get the land for almost next to nothing. You know, he started the farm and he worked on green principles. He grew his own timber to make his fences. They had wooden tools where they could. Things of that sort, you know. I mean, he was 50 years ahead of his time. But the point about it is, here's the man who had encouraged Travelling Morris. He also had a flaming row with the EFDSS, because he suggested that in fact they should change the name from the English Folk Dance and Song Society to the English Festival of Dance and Song Society, suggesting that we should have all around the country weekend festivals which brought together the best of traditional song, dance, the ritual, and so on. Now, in 1924, they thought he was an idiot. 50 years later, when he died, that was the way of things. As a practical man, he organised flax production in this country during the war. He was a liberal of the old sort, politically a liberal. I met him at the Liberal Club in London a number of times. The family also settled in Rhodesia and had a very enlightened policy towards use of native labour and developing them into their own farmships and things like this. But of course, during the UDI period and so on, the family lost all that because of the attitudes of people over there. But he was one of these great unsung heroes in my mind. I think the mill at his Springhead, oh, this is the other thing he did. He believed in back to the land for everybody. And all his professional friends were organised to come for spring and harvesting down on the farm. Doctors and people of that sort, come out of London and feel a workforce and actually do the things by hand in the old way, because they recognised it was good for them. Not necessarily good for farm labourers, it was good for them to actually get this contact with the land. And I went down one year, I should imagine it was 1960, to look at Ralph Gardner's papers, of which he, being a great friend of Mary Neal, had got a lot of material, very interesting material about his, very liked some of his articles. And they had the harvest party going, and they entertained this afternoon. The likes of the most were the idea of entertainment, to settle down in the pub with a good old crack going, and play there. These, no, there's nothing like this. They organised themselves a performance at Tydonenias. They actually set the orchestra up there, and there are the instruments laid out, and if you weren't singing, you played, and you played whatever was a free instrument. there are people that just went from one instrument to another, quite happily playing, the music is absolutely wonderful. And they'd strung up a hawser across the mill, and they had a trolley on this so that somebody could come down from heaven on this trolley with pseudo-claim. It was done in ordinary clothes, because there was no audience. They just did it for their own amusement. Absolutely incredible. Well, as I say, different time, different age, different people, and so on. He believed in hiking. He was one of those who invented the idea of hiking holidays. He used to take parties for walks along the Berkshire Downs, and it was with a friend of his who became a professor of English in the Lebanon between the wars. They walked to the Cotswold villages and found people like Harry Taylor and Charles Taylor Wallington and so on. And again, it was part of the inspiration of getting the travelling Morris to get into the Cotswold and actually see the old tradition. Not that people like Rolf understood it. You have to understand that these people had a cultural background that did not allow them to understand, as it were, the peasants of the time, because it just wasn't the nature thing. People weren't interested. You didn't really have to know. So although there was lots of contact, lots of conversation, the stories that the Morris men told about the old sides, the competitions, the feasts and things of that sort, none of that, or very little that ever got preserved for us. Although that's what we all talked about, that was really of no great interest to the people who were hearing it. So, you've had a long enough rest, make up your sets and do a little bit longer. Now, this introduces a concept that was inherent in Beddington, and that is, it isn't steps that we're going to learn. No, you don't learn a double step, a single step, a back step, and things like this, separate items, which is what you could get away with in like this morning. You can learn in separate steps. You actually have to learn this as a sequence of movement, because every four, it's a four-bar phrase that we're going to do, nothing else, right? Now, it's very easy what we're going to learn is one, two, three, hop, step, and jump. One hop, two hop, step, and jump. Right? Can I have the same music? suggest that Sharpe's visit to Solomon calls that Harry Taylor's eldest son, also called Harry or Henry, tried to raise a sight, but actually started practicing. And these men could still do the step. They stood like this and did. And they didn't do anything with their hands. You see, so I said to them, what did you do with your hands? Stick them in the air, you fool! When I spoke to Douglas Kennedy and say, I've had this embarrassing experience, he said, it's funny you should have that problem, Roy, because when I saw Harry Taylor, I couldn't tell whether he was doing this or that. It was actually just wriggling his wrists. Like this, you see. I made the mistake of explaining that to people who started on the spot. You see, who went mad over the whole thing. See, it's like twists. Now, I have a problem when I teach Morris. His fingers attached to the packet, isn't it? If I do this, I promptly get this back from people. You know, somehow or other, they think the movement is large. Therefore, I have to do my arms all the way around like this. Whereas, in fact, the movement is a frivolous wrist, just enough to keep the hanky going. And it really is not much of this at all. So it's just sort of, you're flipping the wrist. And that's like abnormal for most Morris dancers, but it's basically you are flipping the wrist to make the handkerchief do the work. But what they're afraid of was the jump every two bars, and in the jump it was right, you know, it was a big open out, big bold movement unfolding, and you hold the pose for as long as you can. Now, if you think about gravity is 981 centimetres, no, meters per centimetres per second square. Yes, that's right, centimetres. 981 centimetres per second square, right? Which, if you're trying to work it out with sums, is bloody fast. I know, when you go up in the air, you come down very quickly. Have you noticed that? Yes. Right, so to get actually floating around off the ground, you either require extraordinary energy to get up. Now, there are signs that can get high up, literally get the centre of gravity up, you know. But to do that, you actually have to accelerate to something like 3G. You can do it, but it actually requires significant effort. If you've seen people jumping over something this high, you know, they go over, you know, they have to get the centre of gravity up that far. And that requires an incredible amount of effort. If you can do it, English Olympic side is looking for somebody like you. Right, it is. But there are sides around there who actually can get up. But the likes of you and I, it is not so. Right? You can't do it. But you can have the illusion of getting high. Now, part of the illusion you get, in fact, starting off lower. When you jump, you must say earlier on, your leg muscles, you know, you bend your knees. You know, part of that is that you actually start from down here. You're not actually starting up here when you're trying to. You gain 4 inches, you know, before you, by cheating, as it were. Right? The next thing is you do not gain height by kicking your legs out in front. Anybody can see that's kicking your legs out in front and not getting height. But what you can do is that you can give yourself the maximum chance of getting up. Now, when you normally jump, what part does your arms play? Any thought about that? Yeah, but what do they do? Can you describe it mathematically? What happens is that because movement off the ground is entirely dependent on what happens down there, all that waving your arms around does is change what happens down there. Right? If you accelerate your arms, right, your body has to push your arms up, which means it's pushing the ground harder. Now, as the ground is not moving, well, not today, when you're doing it, the end result is more acceleration to you. So when you swing, you know, the purpose of arms and jump is to actually help you jump higher. As long as you remember, it's acceleration that does it, not coming up smooth. Coming up smoothly doesn't help you. You know that when you try. You actually have to push. But once you're up on the toes leaving the ground, you must stop accelerating, because all more acceleration does is to push you back again. Right? So, is the way to get height. Right? You know, so, you know, think about how you're this athlete. You know, if you're an athlete, that's how you have to analyse your movements in whatever sport or not sport or athletics activity you're involved in. You have to analyse the movement of these sort of things. And then the armors have you to do that. Now another trick, that's giving you physically more effort. The other thing is to actually make it look if you're up there longer. If you watch the ballet, watch the good ballet dancers, women or men, they appear to float. Now, you and I know that they don't float, but what they do is they stop, as it were, doing something about hitting the rain until they actually get there. Well, when they jump, they hold the pose until you can't do anything else but stop. Right? You know, which you don't go and wave your arms around or collapse there. You actually hold it until you're right there. Now, that gains you quite a few inches of apparent height. And as the audience is only watching your heads, you know, not really watching, you actually turn deeper, they think you're up there and floating. They think you're wonderful, right, and doing that sort of thing. So, what are we trying to do? We're going to one, two, three, with a flip of the wrist, one, two, three, and this is your acceleration up to lift, right, and then over the top, hold this beautiful pose, right? To that. Go on, let's try that. Morris is meant to be graceful. Let's try it again. Sideways. Come on, off we go. One, two. two, three, and step and jump. You will notice that sideways on, you are thinner than front legs. Well, both feet.
I would
It's easier to sneak through sideways than it is front on. Let's walk in again. One, two, three, and step and jump.
Up.
Ha ha ha!
Did you actually believe that it's two traditions are the same?
Still,
it's so glad to have a few moments breather, and then we do another one.
Stretch my back. Do you want to go first? Mark, you're not going to see those.
We indeed went in here.
When you do a gallic egg?
In Longbrook, it's a feet together jump, yeah. You follow, yes, you end up feet together.
So it's jump, galley, jump.
Yes, in fact, the galley ends with a jump, another, but I haven't the heart to shake another jump. Well, I remember somebody phoned me up once. We'd done a workshop on Longbrook for a side all day. And the next, on the Sunday, they phoned me up and said, "What did you do yesterday?" So what do you mean? He said, "Well, all through the night he was shading jump, jump in his dream." There's a degree of fitness, I'm afraid. Which is why I think it seems like the tradition I did this morning, why in fact they hit. You know, people actually don't really want these athletic things. Well, only occasionally. Not a heavy diet.
I don't think we could ever really seriously do it. It's me, it's two.
Yes,
no, it's about that at all.
That makes a problem with Jump.
I mean, meeting him halfway down the set.
Oh, we've got bigger feet now, apparently. And more of them. You hear the little pitter patter of big feet.
Forest grew up again in the sort of Saxon times. The Saxons didn't actually plough up everywhere, but some was left alone. And it was declared by Henry II to be royal forest, which meant the forest laws applied and things of that sort. Now, the forest law ran from Kirklington all the way across to Stoke. In fact, it contained pretty well all the Cotswold Morris, the historical Cotswold Morris. Not the North Hampshire bit, but that's so much later thing in time anyhow. So there is some sort of relationship between the Whichford Forest and so on there. Now in the middle of the forest there's a hill, and on top of this hill there's a bit of lazy soil which didn't grow trees, it was always bare. Now anywhere else it would be where St George had killed a dragon and the blood wouldn't let things grow. You know, I mean that's the story elsewhere. Now the Whichford Forest, it was just a clearing in the forest. And when the Normans arrived, it was just called the field. The field. In which we find the field, which means the place called Lee Field. And what do you call a farm that's in the field? Field ten. Field ton. Field ten. Right? So when you go there, you find it's called Lee Field. And everybody calls it Field ten for perfectly good historical reasons. Being in the forest, they're all considered to be gypsies, of course. And therefore not quite right in the head, and you're married into them at, to repent at leisure. The other interesting thing about Leifer, when I think about it, is that there was a shortage of surnames. They more or less, most of them had the same sort of name. You know? So as a result, the families tended to have nicknames for the branches of the family. Reg at the Jubilee in Bampton, Reg Prattley, yeah, Prattley was one of the common names, you see. He was a Samson Prattley. Samson because he had a great uncle who'd been a strong man in the circus and was noted for his ability to lift a horse or a cow off the grave. Why? What to? I don't know. He was a. Another family were known, at least I was introduced, as Baggy Pants. Because one of the forefathers went and buried baggy trousers. So that whole family got known as Baggy Pants. And there was a story about, I'm not sure who true it is, but there's a story in the pub that says that one day somebody from Oxford, one of the villagers had been in hospital in Oxford and got friendly with somebody, and they come looking for that person sometime later. And they said, you know, I'm looking for Mr. whatever his name Prattley was. And he said, this chap got back home to him and said, oh mum, there was some person from Oxford looking for a so-and-so Prattley. And so I know all the Prattleys for miles around. I've never heard of any of you silly folks, you. And there's still an element of that around the place, you know, the shortage of surnames, lost back in the woods and so on. As far as I know, it's had no influence on the Morris whatsoever. But they make wonderful stories. Fieldtown had a side up until the forest was enclosed. Then all sorts of things went wrong in that area. But sides carried on in different villages, including Ascot and Whichford, to the turn of the century. Those dancers I met all considered Ascot was the last traditional side. Fieldtown style side, although there's an obvious difference in the way they actually danced. They themselves, the boys at school, had been trained by an EFDSS teacher who came from Oxford to do Headington dances. In fact, there was one occasion with you at Russell when we thought we were onto something great. We had got up and did these dances in the pub, which we didn't recognise. And after a while, when they started playing bean setting, we realised, on the piano doors, we realised this is just Headington 50 years on. They really, they're doing it on and off there. And it got rather vague in their memories and so on, which is a sanitary lesson for those people who believe that the dancers that we've collected off all men have any resemblance to the way they really were. Still, Fieldtown, the old man, Henry Franklin, he was collected from his cousin, or his younger brother, Alec, was a potter, famous potter. If you go into the museum in Woodstock, you'll see examples of his work. When he retired, he was the classic punch country yokel. He wore a long smock and had a shepherd's crook and would sit outside the Fox and Leaver with his empty tankard waiting for tourists. Telling the tale and so on. And he was very good at it, so they all remember him. And if anybody wants tales, go talk to Reg Pratt, the other Jubilee in Bampton. He grew up in that place. He knew all the old dancers and the tales. Not his dancers, but he knew about them, and people has endless tales about them. And if you get him to have a drink or two with you, you'll find out why he was banned from playing football for life. It's one thing to hit the referee, but to knock him out is another. Right, well, are we in our sets? Now, we all have, I assume, some vague thoughts about how Field 10 goes. Right? Now, we're going to work on it in the same way as you do. The arm movements are nice and gentle for once, right? Field 10 is like Bampton. The stress comes at particular points of the dance. In between, you don't make a great deal of it. It's not all fuss and bother all the way through. It's save your effort for where it matters. The stepping is a classic double step, right? Trying to get the feet to go the same, make forward each foot. And if you don't believe that's important, you'll find in the Morning Post in 1910, there are long letters from people actually explaining how the Morris footstep should actually go. You know, it mattered to people in those days. The Morning Post, for those who don't know, got amalgamated with the Daily Telegraph. And all that this exists of it now is a little bit called the Court Circular, somewhere about page 12, deep inside it. But at one time, the Morning Post was the society, the Daily Tatler, as it were. There were everybody who was anybody actually wrote to and so on. It's distinct from the Times, where it's anybody who knew something wrote to that. A difference. Well, all right, so the basic step. Now, the back step. The Field 10 back step is very interesting because if you read Sharp, it describes it quite clearly as a back step with the foot twisting over, but with the feet, the soles of the foot, on the ground. No, it is not and a dangle type tradition, right? It's a slide and slide. Now, to get the feel of this, I want you to emphasize on the double steps the up, the lift, right? And when you come to the back step, although the body's still going up and down, you emphasize the drop, right? So in one case, it's one, two, hup, hup, and down. Now, the down, you slide the feet on the sole. The way about the hands, the back step, can we just have a little bit of stereo? Foot up, the key thing about Field 10 is that halfway through foot up, you face your opposite. Right? Now, most traditions, you jump and face the other way. And Sherwood, whatever it does, you face out. Field 10, just to be bloody-minded, you face it. Whatever else you're doing, halfway through, you face across. Right? Now, I'm going to teach this sidestep dance because it does not involve the galleys in this particular position. The same galleys in Longra, but the simple set dances of Pure Tone didn't have galleys in them. So let's learn one related, right? Put up. Secondly, that in doing the hay, there's extra bit of twist into it. Right? In other words, we go 1, 2, 3 and 1, 2, 3 so that you can backstep along the line. Right? And that's the trick, up and down the line. So that applies to everybody. Let's get this set for walking. Off you go. Start the hay. 1, 2, 3 and 1, 2, 3. You should go in A, B, there, there. And we're now in the line, and they back up the line. 1, 2, and you jump the pace, right? So you end up in a sort of bunch again, as we did before, but this is only emphasis along the line. Peculiar to field tame, although it's migrated to other people's performance as well as tradition. Right? With the signs. Let's actually, back to where you were, let's all try ahead. Thank you. have actually danced Dagby dancers. And I have chosen for the side I work with half a dozen dancers, but I would say the best Dagby dancers I have seen, and we do those. And that's what I'm going to teach you now. Right? The Dagby that I believe to be Dagby. Right? There's no connection with historical Dagby, and I'll explain where each dance comes from, and so on, and why it's like it's and how it's developed, and things of that sort, just for the fun of it. Right? Now, we'll start, I guess, by learning the figures on what? There, right. Make yourself a normal set. I say that, but I see five people in a line here. Right. The stepping. Will you please start the stepping on the left foot, onto the left foot? I've explained why. One, two, three, and one, two, three, and one, two, three, and cross, cross. Right. Start on the left foot, ready? Now you're going to wonder, which foot crosses first, aren't you? Well, if you think about that, it starts on the left foot. So you want that foot free to lift into the next movement. But each half of each half, as you were starting the left foot, you better cross the left foot second. So you cross right and left. I mentioned it that way, Remy, but that's the way I think about it. I think about what am I doing that with, and the rest falls out naturally, as it were. Right. In other words, I don't actually think that it's right to cross first, I just actually think I've got to end up that way, so I do that, and I don't play on my feet. But let's just try it. Put away your hands for a moment. I promise to play this bit. This is the great thing about captive audience, you know. You get to play, nobody can complain. Not once you've played, have you? Now you shouldn't have a trouble here because everybody's doing it. That lot, of course, will dance on the camera, but otherwise it should fit. You're going to have to move over this way, if you know what I mean. Right? But we should all cast together. We're all to a tired of a song, actually. Right, go, let's all walk. Go on, cast ready. Cross, cross, then cast up again. Cross, cross. Now, when you come up, no matter how compressed you get going round, and it's terribly conventional to get narrow set, you're going to be far enough apart now to actually do a chorus or whatever you're going to do. Right, so you're going to be reasonable apart. But that's right. That's the cast rein. I should call it cast, right? Face, though, really face. The second figure is set. Set straight. Into line, half jib, shoulder to shoulder, and no further. One, two, three hop. Then on the spot. One, two, three hop. Back to place, one, two, three hop. Cross, cross. Now the other side, into nine, left shoulders. One, two, three, hop. One, two, three, hop. Back, two, three, hop, cross, and cross. Now you'll begin to understand the argument about being fingertip apart. When you get into line and realise you're doing these high circles, right? Yeah, go into line, dance into line. And circles. You'll realise there's a certain problem. Take this. Now there's your neighbours in the way. But they're not really in the way, because you're shoulder to shoulder. You've got your hands in behind them. Right? You're actually doing the circles behind. And this is where the phrasing of the movement matters, because you want to back out and you want to pass them when your hands are in, not when they're going out. Right? There's no prize for hitting your neighbour in the ears. Right? That's half jib. Back to back, of course, is fairly obvious. There's an interesting crossover. Hold your partner's right hand and go round halfway round. One, two, three, and one, two, three. Then let go and face. On the spot, one, two, three, and cross, cross. Then the other hand back. One, two, three, and hold, two, three, face, two, three, cross, cross. Right, let's do that. step, we're going to clap our hands. Right, we're going to do diddy yum dum dum. Diddy yum dum dum. Right? Back behind together while you cross tum tum. Three against two. Difference as badly to anything else. And that is at the halfway point, though the middles face across, the ends face up and down. So now walk the halfway. One, two, this is the whole way, half of the whole way. One, two, three. One, two, three. Now for cross tops, you at the bottom face down, you at the top face up, and you face across. So you do it that way, which is unique to Badgley. When you carry on the second half, diddle-diddle-diddle, carry on, diddle-diddle-diddle. When you do it like that, depends on whether it's a figure buried in the dumps or if it's the last figure when you all do it facing up. Right? It relies on the foreman to say all up or up and down. Well, that's about as well. It's the basis of that dance is that there are, besides the few dancers collected, there are a long list of dance titles, of which Flowers and Resemble was one. And the Shepherd's Hay dance, which in the book works, is given both as a stick and as a handkerchief, a hand clapping version. A fame, or these winds of fame, that Flowers and Resemble were fitted the hand clapping so much better than. You know, because you've got the, which is the rhythm of the actual hand clapping, so it's far better. Right. Now, will you all get yourself a stick, please?
Cross over!
going to be honest with you now, right? Growl like the electric.
We're going to go cross over by going one, two,
three, hit backwards. That's to knock the mud off the beanstick, right? One, two, three, and then I'm going to hit him. Who hits him? Who hits him? Who hits him? Who hits him? And she doesn't get a chance to hit me. Because we ran into music. Ah! Right. And then you come back. One, two, three, four. One, two, three. Hit. Now, just a minute. I've got this wrong. Why don't you start hitting it? Damn. I thought I was safe. All right, then you hit him. One, two, three. Hold it that long, right? So let's try and do it with music now. The upper ding, the under the diddly, under the dee dee dum bum dee, the under the dee under the dee dum bum dee, under hit, 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 da 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 dee da 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 dee, under the dee under the dee under the dee dee dee, and hit. Now that's only half the dance. Let's learn that just to start with. Right? Everybody walking first leg music. Off we go. Three. That one.
six, is it? One and six. Oh, I see six.
Thank you.
is comes from not making taps, from making good big movements. You know, you can get a good whack in without making it too hard. You can get what looks like a very full move in it. It's that peeling over of the streams, as it were, which makes the dance so particularly effective. Right. Now, put your sticks down and we do second Morris. we hit the food will be arriving soon syndrome. You can eat as well after that, eh? Right, then, it's a bit longer course than normal, so face opposite. And I also let into another secret, that my side that does this dance, we decided it's too long to do all of it, so we only do half of it. Right, you'll understand why I'm stopping you. You face! We're going to do open, long open sidestep to our left. Then back to face. Then two bars of stepping on spot. Then we're going to cross over with two basically slow capers, which are two plain capers and two cross hops, right? And then there's a half pay, and we do it all again. Right, let's walk our way through from the beginning. To the left. On the spot these two are. Then, caper, caper, cross, cross. Caper, caper, cross, cross. Now we should be in a line facing eight, ready to go into a half hay with plenty of time to spare, right? The middles have to turn in, the others just go the way they're facing. So off we go a half hay. This being a half hay, you do the cross step facing across. Now, side step to your left again. Two on the spot. Yada diddly dada da di. Caper, caper, cross, cross. Caper, caper.